Good Sunday morning, everybody. The numbers are simply astounding. Almost 19 million Americans have it. 9.5% of the adult population in the U.S. It is something that will happen to everyone at some point in their life. 23% of children, 30% of women, 41% of them too embarrassed to get help. It is depression. And it is the subject of a new book by a well-known and popular Kansas Cityan. You see him on TV, you hear him on the radio. Kansas City Royals broadcaster Ryan LeFebvre, who along with award-winning journalist for the Kansas City Star Jeff Flanagan, have written this book, The Shame of Me, One Man's Journey to Depression and Back from Ascend Books. Ryan LeFebvre with us this morning. It is great to have you here.
Thank you, Kris.
On this Sunday morning. First of all, how are you?
I'm doing great. Thank you. I really am. I do have the approach in my life that I suffer from depression, and it's an ongoing battle, but it's something that I've learned to manage. But I've never taken the approach of this is something either you have or you don't have, and there's some sort of a magic cure.
At what point did you get your arms around the fact that this is why you weren't feeling well?
Well, the book begins with a rather dramatic scene of me sitting in the closet of my home, weeping and literally desiring the comfort of my mother. I wasn't 7 years old, I was 34 years old. So I knew there was something terribly wrong. I tried to sleep through it, felt just as horrible the next day. But I think the most telling symptom for me that I wasn't feeling depressed, that I was depressed, and I learned through therapy, was that there was an incongruency in my life. There was nothing dramatic as far as life circumstance that was happening. I was reacting that way. So my life circumstance and my feelings were not lining up, and that's when I learned that this was more of a condition and not just a feeling.
I'll go back to a number that I quoted at the top of the segment. 30% of women have it, 41% of them too embarrassed to get help. I don't know what the number is among men. I assume it is high. Was that a hurdle for you to clear?
Sure, absolutely. I mean, especially sports fans who are watching the Chiefs on Sunday or the Royals, and they are hit with all these light beer commercials where life tells men in the United States, hey, go get a big job that pays you a lot of money and live life with a lot of flash. And when you accumulate and achieve all these things, happiness will follow. And so there is a great deal of shame, I think, among men. And I think it's interesting, the statistics that you read, I've heard the same ones. And, you know, there's a medical explanation. Women certainly have hormonal changes to deal with that we as men don't have to. But I think women are much more wired to go to a doctor and say, I'm not feeling well. I'm crying a lot. I don't feel like I belong. I feel very empty, whereas most men are going to turn to pouring themselves into work, alcohol, drug addictions, become a workaholic, go to the gym constantly, find other ways to deal with the problem, whereas women are more inclined to deal with their actual condition.
To hear that Ryan LeFebvre, the very well-known, very popular broadcaster of the Kansas City Royals, suffers from depression, for people who are looking at this segment for the first time who did not know, I suspect people are thinking to themselves, you know, he's young, he's good looking, he has a great job, he's popular in town. How in the world could Ryan LeFebvre suffer from depression?
Yeah. You know, Kris, I asked myself all those questions. I really did. There were days where I would take a step back from my own life and think, you know, how in the world am I suffering from this? And I think what was even more challenging was if I have all of these things, how am I going to get better? I mean, what's left on the list for me to accomplish and achieve that's going to allow me to feel better? But the journey for me was not so much moving forward to the next thing. It was about turning around and going back to the beginning and saying, you know what, in our business, you know, we have a lot of privileges. We have a lot of notoriety, high-profile jobs. So I think there's this inclination that we are supposed to let other people live vicariously through us and do all of the things that everyone else wish they could do if they were in a position that we were. And what we do is we begin to live their lives or live our culture's lives, or we begin to live as men these light beer commercials when it really isn't the true desire of our heart. Again, not very masculine things to talk about, but at the same time, that this story is about a man going through depression, but it's also a story about someone who was fed this lie of here's how you find happiness in the United States of America and drank the Kool-Aid and became very ill because of it.
The road to recovery began for you how and perhaps where?
Acknowledgement of the fact that I can't figure this one out.
And how difficult was that?
You know, not as difficult as it had been years past. Years past, I think I was influenced by others who would say, well, there's something else to achieve. You'll feel better after a while. And there was some measure of truth to that, but I think it wasn't as difficult for me when I hit the bottom because I realized I'm bankrupt here.
And was the bottom that day in Cleveland?
It was one of the bottoms. I think I had experienced some pretty dramatic lows, but the Cleveland incident was the first time where I realized I give up. You know, I'd done some treatment, I'd been on medication. I mean, I had opened up to other people about what was going on, but I hadn't gotten better. And there was that day in Cleveland where I was going to wait for everyone to go to the ballpark. And when the lobby was cleared, I was going to check myself into a hospital. And if they asked me for what, I would say, I don't know, but you're either going to check me in right now or you're going to have to be cleaning me up off the street because I give up.
And the book obviously details your recovery from depression.
Yeah.
But recovery also, I think, implies that you're there, you've reached the finish line, that you're cured, mm-hmm. when in fact, there's no such thing.
No, there really isn't. You know, it's reconditioning myself. You know, it's almost a purification process. And, you know, purification is not becoming perfect. Purification, in the literal sense, is to unlearn certain behaviors that I learned when I was young and I never got rid of. And so the reconditioning is no different than going to a gym and hiring a personal trainer and saying, I want to lose this much weight or this much body fat. And you achieve your goal, but then you decide that when you're done, you're going to start eating fast food again. It's something that can be achieved. There is not necessarily a finish line, there's an accomplishment line, but there's constant management that goes with it.
All right, the book, The Shame of Me, One Man's Journey to Depression and Back from Ascend Books, and I assume that you have book signings coming up in town?
Yeah, I have one coming up on the 30th. We'll be at Naomi's Hallmark, Shawnee Mission Parkway in Quivira, and anyone who suffers from this, or maybe more importantly, someone who has a loved one that suffers from this. I think it's a story of understanding what's going on inside the mind of someone who really feels trapped.
With the Stars, Jeffrey Flanagan, the Royals, Ryan LeFebvre. All the best to you.
Thank you so much, Kris.
Thank you.